Okay. We structure a bit these days in the following way. I will first give a presentation about why we have this concept of network disruption in this exhibition, and also how we started as a research and also as a practice. And then we will have two panels today. And I will be the moderator, so I'm sorry if you will get tired of me at a certain point, but I will try to entertain you as much as I can. And I decided first to give you a bit of an introduction of this concept, because I think that it's important to understand also why I'm actually using this discourse of disruption. And going on with the slides, I want to show you the cover of the book. That is the book I wrote between 2008 and 2011 when I was researching at Aarhus University. And this has been for me the conclusion of a conclusion that is also a start of a path that actually started already many years before. And I want to share with you a bit of this path that has to do also with my private engagement in the political underground movement in Italy, and at the same time also with other experience that I had after, that also made me reflect and maybe made me think that was perhaps really useful and really important to start to redefine certain practices, because certain logic we had in the past didn't work anymore. And so I start a bit from the roots. this is a picture that I usually like to show. And it's me with other bunch of people in 1999 during the hack meeting in Milano. The hack meeting is a collective encounter of different Italian activist hackers people that like to reflect and act critically. And in that time, we actually had a lot of hope on information technology, openness, and do-it-yourself culture. And this was an important time in Italy in the 90s, because the people started to get with a lot of passion into the use of technology as a moment of critical and political intervention. And at the same time, we were speaking a lot about cyber rights and accessibility of information, and also do it yourself as a practice that was not only to apply on technology, but also on our everyday life. And so this was a bit of the time, and going on with the paths that I want to share with you. And I think it's important to get a bit personal here, because the other people that will speak today and tomorrow, I think they probably will really speak about practices that have been part of their personal life. So this moment of the interference between art and life, that is also, if you want, proper of the avant-garde since ever, then it's something that is really important also to understand why we use networking in a certain way. And so in 2001, as part of the Italian underground technological movement, we were also really connected with what in that time was called the anti-globalization movement, that to be sincere, we really didn't like this definition, because we thought that was actually a global movement. But by the way, this was the way that the journalists usually were referring to that. And for me, this was an important moment, because this image is coming from the protest anti-G8 in Genoa in 2001. And this was really a moment in which a big part of the Italian movement started to reconsider center practices, especially practices of frontal opposition, because actually the police really busted everybody. It was really a terrible tragedy for many. I don't know if you are old enough to remember that, but if you were part of the movement at the time, for sure you remember. And this thing really struck my mind, because I thought that we really perhaps need other kind of practices, other kind of strategies that are not necessarily based on frontal opposition, because if you just create a frontal opposition, the risk is that what you call your enemy will appropriate you and will actually be legitimated by you. And so this would create like a chain of security and control that is much stronger than your opposition. And so I changed a bit perspective and I moved to Berlin in 2003 and I started to be part of the queer and the pink movement. So I think the best way to define it is with this color and also with not image. And for me that was really interesting because people were really trying to apply the strategy of playful intervention into political demonstration but also on into their own body. And the idea also mixing media, body, pornography, sexuality was part of this tactic. And but still this was a bit my time in the middle of the 2000s. Was also the same time in which the web 2.0 started to appear. And I think that's, you know, you can really see this aesthetic, how different it is from this one. And I think that maybe you also get immediately that something is a bit fake. And at least this is the way I experienced that. I thought that a lot of the practices that we were doing since many years then started to be totally appropriated by the market and also by what was called in 2004 through Tim O'Reilly the web 2.0. And so today of course we could say that networking is mostly that, so because everybody is using Facebook, is using, you know, Twitter, YouTube and whatever. But what you will see in these days and also in the next of the exhibition in the opening is that actually networking is starting way before, and also the people will be with us later will tell you better than me. And so I started to reflect and I say, okay, but how is possible that all the concept of openness, do it yourself, and also, you know, many of the instances of the underground culture now are totally part of the corporation rhetoric. So I went to do a trip in San Francisco and US. And I met somebody like John Lowe and also many other great people there because I wanted to investigate the roots of Web 2.0, where actually this contamination between art, business, disruption, and hacker culture came. And there I met also people like Lee Felsenstein that told me that actually, and also we knew already, that hacker culture and hacker practices has been always contaminated by business since the beginning. And so this is basically the history of the Silicon Valley. And when I met John Lowe, that we'll also speak tomorrow, he also made me think something really interesting because he showed me the architecture of Burning Man Festival from above and he told me this really looks like a centralized architecture in which the man that is usually born at the end of the festival, this is a big festival in northern Nevada, in the desert of Nevada, is occupying a central spot in the camp of all the people. And the architecture in the past was much more different, probably. I don't know if he will speak about that, but for me, this image in my mind had a direct link with the centralized social networking. And I say, okay, this is a bit the example that, you know, this idea of real life and if you want virtual life, like we were saying in the 90s, now are totally contaminating each other, and also the idea of business is totally part of the development of social networks. And this is a pretty centralized moment in which you realize, okay, now I'm having my networking experience in a platform that is also making revenue by that and by the use of the data that I put into that. And by having all this reflection, then I created this model that is also the starting point from, I would say, this book and also the exhibition of today. And this model is called the disruptive feedback loop because basically you see that there is a mutual combination between art, business and disruption. Then you could say that, for example, hackers or artists have been functional to business also to create disruption. And at the same time, it's also possible for art artists, hackers, and activists to create a disruption by interfering with business. So it's a mutual feedback loop that's start from the very definition of disruption. And disruption means to introduce in the market a product that the market doesn't expect, and is a definition that comes from business culture. The first one that started to use the term disruptive innovation was Clayton Christensen from the Harvard Business School in the 90s. And so his idea was that there are possibility of creating a disruptive innovation that interferes with the market from the inside and change the market from within. And then I say, okay, since now we could say that we are totally contaminated by business and there is not anymore a difference between underground practices and the, you know, corporation appropriation of that, then I made a sort of the tournament and I apply business to the discourse of art and hacktivism. And then I started to thought about the idea of disruption as a moment in which you try to interfere from the system, in the system from the inside. So the moment in which you also create a new vision by acting inside the system that you want to oppose. So in that sense becomes not anymore an opposition, but is a sort of perturbation of disturbance that is also playing with this coexistence of opposition between art, business and disruption. So the moment of playing is really important because is really something that is coming by the idea also of dismantling a single truth, a single definition of a practice. And many of the people that I also involved in this exhibition and I wrote about in my book are people that have been playing with this discourse of the truths, of virality, of perturbation, of fakes, plagiarism, and I think then the panels of today will explain us this really in depth, so I don't want to go too much into this. I just want to say that for me, disruption, at least in this line of thought that I'm following, means to generate practices and intervention that are unexpected and play within the system under scrutiny. And in that sense, we could say that artists and hackers are adopting viral and flexible strategy as does networking business. And I would say a good example of that is Anonymous, and I want to speak a bit about that because there is nobody in the exhibition and in this animal that is speaking in depth about the movement. I don't know, maybe Florian will refer to that, I'm not sure. But Anonymous is something that probably many of you know because it's a pretty recent practice and entity, totally symbolized the idea that you have to change your strategy and you have to become pervasive. And also since capitalism needs our revolution because in that sense they can increase market production and also business production, and at the same time we could say that system of powers needs our opposition because they increase security and form of control, then Anonymous is something that is totally difficult to appropriate because it's playing with the discourse of the truth, force you to question actually even what is it, and at the same time it's made by people that don't have a political agenda, are not following a mandate, and they are basically nobody. And this kind of line of thoughts then brought me to be interested in the discourse of whistleblowing. That is why tomorrow in the seminar we will have with us also Andy Machon, that is a former MI5 agent coming from UK. And in Berlin, that is the city where I'm still living, after the Snowden revelation, there have been a big debate of people starting to discuss on freedom of information, on security, on cryptography, and so on. And the way I also interpret whistleblowing for me is also a disruption that comes from within, because it's totally trying to come from the inside of the system that have been opposed, but also is usually made by people that understand the logic of the system because they are part of that. And then they decide also to make a change. And this change also has to do with their private life and also with the idea of exposing bugs in these systems. And so, I mean, I was discussing recently also this subject, and I think also what the whistleblower does is totally the tournament, because in this moment of gesture in which there is a change of personal life and also of point of view, then you can say that still you are really making a transformation, of, if you want, of social and cultural meaning. And I mean, I also shouldn't mention here, because in the seminar there will be one of the Janet Jansa that also did the personal change with a gesture that is pretty performative and has to do with his own private life. So I think probably you understand now the line of thoughts. So we go a bit into the exhibition, and I imagine to bring some people that have been part also of my research and my practice for some really many years together, and at the same time also try to create a sort of network disruption. So it's important to say that it's not a network disruption, but it's networked. That means that again is referring to this business disruptive loop, and also with the fact that not only is possible to create interesting combination among groups, but also inside the same group, because often the people don't have the same perspective. Like Neuism was a total example of that. Even people were not agreeing on what Neuism was and who was Monty Kansen. And so in the exhibition we will have different rooms that have been also conceptualized with people part of this group, because I didn't want to be the classic curator that say, okay, now I'm dealing with this subject that is difficult, because of course it's harder to appropriate, that is the point of the whole thing, and so why I should actually represent it. And maybe there should have been no any exhibition about that, but then we decide also with Janet to take this challenge, and we say, okay, maybe we try to work on discourse of representation that are not actually representing anybody, but at least we are trying to do it from the inside. And so for each room, I had a strict collaboration of people that are part or at least research really in depth on these movements, and they have been working with me really closely to conceptualize this show. So, for example, I can say that Vittore Baroni has been totally the curator of the male art room. Florian Kramer was working with me really closely to do the Neuism room, Gabriella Coleman for the Anonymous room, and of course John Lowe for the Suicide Club, Cacophony Society, and Billboard Liberation Front, and Andrea Natella for the Luther Brisset movements and the projects, and also the members of the Anna Adamolo network, and we will have one here that maybe I don't mention because she doesn't like, but then she can't avoid to be on stage, so you will meet her. And at the same time also there are single artists that contributed, of course Janet Jansa, then Julian Oliver, Laura Poitras, L'Alliance Invisible, Peng Collective, and I hope I didn't, Trevor Paglin, and the Telecomunisten, of course, with their big octo pneumatic distribution system project. And I just conclude also to do a little propaganda for myself, because since the propaganda is part of this show, I also want to do it. And so I say that I'm also launching a new project in Berlin that we start in April. It's called Disruption Network Club. It's a series of conferences that will go on from April until December. And so since they are really connected also with this subject, I invite you to come and have a look at the disruptionlab.org website if you want to keep on being interested in these conspiracy practices and disruptive intervention. Thank you.